Hi, I'm Julia Anderson here at Smart Money, where we talk about all things money with my co-host here, Pat Boyle. And we have a special guest that we really enjoy having on the show, J.D. Roth, who has been a longtime blogger at GetRichSlowly.org. Mm-hmm. And J.D. has, let me just tell you a little bit about J.D., okay? So J.D. was one of the first people to get online with a money blog. And so at this point, after how long, 12 years?
No, 15?
15. Oh my gosh. 15 years.
13, 4, somewhere in that neighborhood.
Okay, after 15 years,
I can't even
years,
do the math anymore.
You are a self-taught expert because you've lived through a lot of what you
ups
write
and downs.
About.
Yes.
Right, and you started out, you know, kind of buried in debt and over your head with money issues, even though you had a good job. And you worked your way out of that and started writing about it at GetRichSlowly.org. Then it was so successful, you walked away from that for a while,
yep.
And now you're back. You're
now
back.
Now I'm back. Yes,
I
back. Bought it back.
And so what we're here to talk about today is, because I know at least lately you've changed your approach a little bit. You're doing more in-depth reporting.
Right.
And you went out and did a big report on American consumer behavior for the last 70 years?
Yeah, well, it's not, I don't want to claim that I'm the one digging up the statistics.
Well, I know.
Yeah,
you found all the numbers.
Yes.
So
yeah.
Anyway, getting to the point is you found some good news and some not so good news. So why don't you start out by telling us a little about where you got the information,
sure.
And what the good news is.
So I got the information from the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics. So what a lot of people might not know is the U.S. government websites, they're actually pretty amazing. They do a darn good job with it. Like the IRS website, it's got all the information you could ever want there. They try to be as forthcoming as possible.
And it's IRS.gov, right?
Yes. And they've got all sorts of tools there. You can go check your Social Security statement. Well, you can't
that's
check it with the IRS.
That's,
yes, that's Social Security.
SSA.gov.
Look at you know
she's
this stuff.
Good.
I know. Yeah. So the Bureau of Labor Statistics, well, they collect all sorts of statistics. And they survey people around the country. And once a year, they do what they call the Consumer Expenditure Survey. And I don't know the exact methodology behind it. But they survey enough people that they're able to get data on how Americans spend their money, what their income is, and also a bunch of different demographic stats behind Americans.
By age.
Well, they break it down by all sorts of stuff.
By race, by everything.
Yes.
By where you live.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so you can sort through these tables. And it's really nerdy stuff that probably is only... It really only appeals to economists and money nerds like us.
Yeah, but what should we know about? There's some things in there that I think everybody should know about.
Yeah, well, yeah. So for example, so the data, like you say, goes back 70 years.
Mm-hmm.
They did a survey like this in, I think it was 1941, and then they did another one in the early 60s, 1961, and then in 1973. And then in 1984, they started doing them annually, so it became an annual survey. So since 1984, so what is that? That's 35 years?
Right.
We have complete data every year. And before that, we have sporadic data. And this consumer expenditure survey shows how much Americans earn.
Mm-hmm.
It shows what they tend to spend their money on.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like you say,
there's good news.
Yes.
Okay, hit us with the good news.
We hear a lot of times about how salaries are stagnant or going down, and that's not really the case. The Consumer Expenditure Survey shows that, generally speaking, the average American earns more now, adjusted for inflation,
mm-hmm.
than they did 30, 35 years ago. And this trend is just, it's pretty much, it goes up. And I told you in advance that I have to cheat because these are statistics and they're tables.
Go ahead.
I've got my iPad here with me to look at the numbers. And so if you look at inflation adjusted income before taxes, in 2018, the average household income was about $78,000 per year. But if you go back to 1988, cherry picking that because
sure.
It's 30 years ago.
Yeah.
It was about 60,000. So Wages have gone up about 20-25% when you adjust for inflation.
Well, didn't your stats also look at how many people in that household are working, and now there are more women in the workforce, and that really happened after World War II, and so is that part of the increase in salary?
Yes,
household income.
It is. It's interesting. Well, since 1988, the number of wage earners per household is roughly the same. It's about 1.4, 1.3, something like that. Hmm. But yeah, before World War II, it was less than one income earner per household, which I don't understand how that works, but it was 0.8.
One of the things that interested me was we're spending less on food. What were the stats for back in the 40s or whatever? It was like 30% of your income or more you spend on food.
Right.
And it's less now. And I was wondering, is that because it's food that is in the can or is frozen and it's not the fresh food? I mean, is that why it's cheaper?
I think it's just more mass produced. And so I think if when you look at the food, in 1941, I think the number was 31% of household income went toward food spending. And I think if you look at 1941, I wasn't alive, but I imagine it was much more local food and it was much more labor intensive to produce that food.
Oh, that makes sense.
So it's more expensive.
Yeah.
I can pile on that. So your numbers are 31% of a food budget in 1941, and we're down to 12.9%.
Wow.
So that's a huge drop. But
it's
I would say it's two things. It's competition in the grocery business, and everything is going toward
who
can make a penny on whatever you're selling. And then secondly, we actually have overproduction in this country.
Yeah.
We have overproduction in dairy and wheat and a whole lot of things that are holding down the price.
But aren't we worried about a French fry shortage these days?
I'm sure.
I just read that.
Is there a French fry shortage?
I know. Yes. It's
is it
awful.
A potato thing?
That's a whole other segment.
Crop issue with the weather. So,
wow.
Yeah. But what else? I mean, talk about cars for a minute. I know you had some data on cars and how many we own.
Okay. I'm going to have to look this up because I don't know the number off the top of my head. I'm imagining that we have a much higher number of autos. So in 1973, the average household owned 1.3 cars per household.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's about 2 cars per household. So yeah, each household owns 50% more cars than it did.
Let me test my theory out for you on that. So I just talked to somebody in Estacada recently, and they were saying, we've seen an increase in growth in the last year. And I go, really? I mean, what's drawing people to Estacada? And his answer was, this was the economic development manager for the city, and he said, people are getting priced out of homes in Portland, so they're moving out further, and Estacada is about a 45-minute drive. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering if the cost of housing is driving the increase in cars, like, we'll buy a second car and live out there. I mean, that could be a reason, couldn't it?
It absolutely could be. The real interesting thing with all these economic numbers and the statistics is it's really hard to find causal relationships, especially for somebody like me who's just a money nerd going in and looking at the government data.
We can all guess.
Yes. So, yeah. There are all sorts of things. You're absolutely right that home prices have skyrocketed over the past, here in Portland, over the past 10 years they've increased. But when you look at the past 30 years, they've really ballooned. And so that could absolutely be feeding into other things like pushing people to have more automobiles. And so this leads to some of the bad news. I mean, the good news is
let's do one more good news thing.
Okay.
I want to do one more good news
thing.
And I loved it that you did all this research. So one of the good news things is education.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Tell us about that.
So the education stuff is interesting to me. I almost didn't believe it when I first saw the numbers because you're looking back at when I was a boy in 1973, I would have been 4 years old. 79% of people, only 79% of people attended high school, which means 21% of people didn't even go to high school.
That's so surprising to me. I mean,
And yet when I think of my own family, I know there were plenty of people in my family. I have a large extended family, and a lot of my cousins didn't go to high school. So I'm like, okay, that makes sense. But in 2018, 97% of people attended high school. This isn't graduating. This is actually
they were at least in high school.
Yes, I think it's something like 84% of people
graduate.
So
that's a huge change.
Yeah, it's a huge change. In the college, it's a similar thing. In 1973, 28% of people attended college. They at least went to college for a little bit. And now it's 2/3 of people, 67% of people attend college at least for a little bit. And the graduation rate, it's 37% of Americans now graduate from college. And I think that's fantastic. It's amazing.
And that means higher income.
In theory, yes. Well, and actually, yes, it does.
It does.
I shouldn't poo-poo that, because it absolutely does.
I think they do. Some studies have shown, you know, if you have a college degree, you're going to make X number of dollars more than if you don't have one.
So. It's not, you can obviously cherry pick and find cases where people don't, they do go to college or they even get a graduate degree and they don't make a lot of money. You can absolutely do that. But the numbers are incontrovertible that in general, the better educated you are, the more money you are going to make.
So let me just review the good news out of your report is we're better educated. Mm-hmm. We own more cars. we make more money. And what was the other thing?
We pay less for food.
Food prices are way down. So all that is all good news. So now what's the bad news?
The bad news, with the increase in the number of cars, a larger percentage of our budget is being spent on automobiles.
Oh.
So in the olden days, I think it was something like 13%. Again, I have to refer to my numbers because these are all statistics.
I like that you brought all those numbers.
Yeah.
Why don't we do that?
It's 13%.
Get rid of all this
paper. Here we go. Transportation numbers. It was 15, let's say... Oh, it's roughly the same. See, I'm going to talk about how transportation is this bad news thing, but it's roughly the same. About 18-19% is what we spend on transportation.
Okay, but
the housing.
The big issue is, I think you said that our income is not keeping up with our spending, right? We're spending more than we make. Isn't that something you sort of said?
I don't think we're spending more than we make, but we're saving less. That's absolutely for certain.
Okay.
So the percentage of our income that we're setting aside for savings is less.
Savings.
And I think part of that is because we are spending more on housing. The percentage that we spend on housing has absolutely increased. And this is a big concern.
Yeah.
So in 1941, 1961, we're spending 28-29% of our income on housing on average, the average American. And today, those numbers are closer to 33-34%. And that might not sound like it's very much, but it is a significant increase. Yeah, it's a 10-15% increase over what we were spending. And the real issue is, when we talk about food, and food has dropped from 31% to about 13% of the average American household expenses, food is something that you can manage from week to week. You can clip coupons. It's something that you can tackle, and it's something that you can work towards lowering. But housing is this huge expense, and to like make cuts on housing. Say you get into a financial bind. Somebody in your household loses their job, and all of a sudden you're having trouble meeting the rent or making the house payment. Well, it's much more difficult to trim your housing costs quickly than it is to trim your food budget. To trim your household, your housing expenses, you'd have to move, right?
Or take in a renter.
Find some way to cut that housing expense, and it's much more difficult. And also that with the housing expense being 33% of the average American budget and food only being 13%, there's not as much room for error, I guess. If you take on a housing payment that's too big, you're really in a bind.
You're putting yourself on the
And I speak from experience. I've done this in the past myself. In 2004, my then wife and I, we bought a house that on paper we could afford, but once we got into the house, we're like, oh my gosh, we had not counted on all of these expenses. Mm-hmm. And it was squeezing the life out of me. And then that was actually the reason I ended up starting the website, is because I was feeling so pinched. I felt like I was drowning in debt. I told myself, I got to figure out what I'm doing here. And
that's exactly why we had you on the show, because we know you figured that out. And if you go to getrichslowly.org, there's a lot of great advice from J.D. Roth, our guest today, on how to take charge of your money. And I think this report is really helpful. I mean, I kind of like statistics. I'm coming from a business writer background.
Yeah.
So I just like it for the information. But what we can all conclude from it, I think, Pat, is that there are some factors in our economy now. One of them is higher housing costs, that you need to be really careful how much debt you take on. in this economy where even though we're spending less on food and some of these other things, you better watch your budget and make sure you have an emergency fund in case something happens. A few of those kinds of things. So,
and I have to tell you that the number one piece of advice I give people is do what you can to keep your housing costs low.
Say that again.
Do what you can to keep your housing costs low. I think it's so important. It's just vital.
Okay. Well, you know, on that note, we're going to conclude and say thank you again, JD.
Thank you.
And here we are at Smart Money. Thanks a lot.
For more information, go to my website at 60andsingle.com.